imagine every day, okay, sharp at 12 a.m. at night, midnight, God gives you, He credits 86,400 rupees in your bank account every single day. So what will all of us do? All of us will spend as much as we can. I need to start by saying that I am not a child psychologist, nor am I a parents counselor. I am a parent like any one of you. I have my horrible days, okay, and I have my good days as a parent. But maybe the reason why Joffin called me, like he said, maybe is because I am handling more than one profession, and I'm somehow able to manage it all and take care of my children literally alone. No, we haven't been divorced. My husband is still very much with me, but he is traveling. He is actually working in the Merchant Navy. So my elder son is 8 years old, going to be 8. And I think I have single-handedly brought him up because of the nature of my husband's profession. So I have that experience of, you know, doing a few things along with the parenting and trying to be not supremely successful, but moderately successful in whatever I do. Again, so like I said, these will be my whatever knowledge I have garnered through a little bit of reading and through a little bit of experience, I will be sharing with all of you today. The fact that I'm a teacher and a trainer, there will be elements of a little bit of preachiness. Okay, so beware, behold, I can go into the lecture mode. So in case you feel like I'm going there, you can always stop me and tell me. So I need to also say this, that each child is different, each parent is different, and hence every equation is different, every parenting style is different. I am nobody to tell you that this is how you should do, because if something works for me, you know, my parenting style doesn't work for my two children. With my son, I have to adopt a totally different way, and with my daughter, another totally different way. So I am nobody to tell you this. So that is what I wanted to tell you initially. Okay. So please don't consider me as the know-it-all of time management. I am a fledgling there. I'm still trying to manage. Okay. Manage time. That is the first question. And like most of us are aware, all of us talk about time management. We cannot manage time. Time is a finite source, but not in our control, okay? All we can do is we can manage what we do with our time. That is the only thing that we can manage. You know, to my trainees, I ask them a question. Imagine every day, okay, sharp at 12 a.m. at night, midnight, God gives you, He credits 86,400 rupees in your bank account every single day. But the problem is that by the time it becomes 11:59 p.m. that day, you have to spend it. Whatever is left in the bank account, God will take it back. So what will all of us do? All of us will spend as much as we can, because, you know, that money won't come back, right? Fortunately, but without us realizing, God is crediting something equally valuable in all our accounts every single day at 12 a.m. And that is 86,400 seconds. So He is giving us 86,400 seconds. The thing is, what do we do with it? It's totally different ballgame. You know, if it was money, we would have spent it all wisely. At times we would have splurged it also, but are we actually managing these seconds well? That is a question. So when I, you know, I do read a lot as part of my training and my teaching and things like that. So this article came across, it's an HBR, Harvard Business Review article. It came across to me very coincidentally, and I read it and I thought I'd hit jackpot, because after that, my parenting has certainly improved. And the title of the article was Manage Your Energy and Not Your Time. So the article was written by, so that I don't forget names, I've written it down, okay? So the article was written by Tony Schwartz and Catherine McCarthy. And they were talking about energy people have. Okay, just think about it yourself. When are you the most energetic in a day? Okay, I will talk about myself as an example. I am the most energetic when I get up. Okay, I can do a lot of things in that first half of the day. Afternoon 2 to 4 is slump. I cannot do creative writing. If I train during that time, people will sleep, so will I. So it's my most dullest period. And then by around 4:30, that energy comes back again and I'm active till I go to bed. Okay, so if you analyze, all of us have peaks and valleys in our energy. And they say that in order to be productive, in order to manage everything effectively, this article was written for employees in organization. But my God, the way it is applicable to parenting, no bounds to it. So I'm planning to rewrite that article in the context of parenting because it makes a lot of sense for us parents. So they say that your time is a finite source, but energy is not like that. It is, you can renew your energy, okay? If you rest for some time, maybe if you take a nap for 10 minutes or if you do a brain break activity or maybe if you walk a few paces, your energy will come back, okay? So it is your energy that you need to manage. Again, by you and us, we need to manage. All right, now, what do you mean by energy? Energy is the capacity to do work, okay? And parenting needs a lot of energy, like all of us know, right? It is the capacity to manage and rear children. So the energy basically comes from the main four pillars of, or the more, the four sources from where all of our energy comes is the physical, the body. Then there is emotion, there is mental energy, and there is spiritual energy. Okay, so we need to manage these energies well. So when your physical, all these energies are at its best, you need to do the most difficult task that you have planned for the day during that time. Okay, now, have you planned your day out? That is the first question. So if you want to manage your energy well and ensure that the day goes by well, as parents also, I'm coming to the parenting bit just now, you need to ensure that your plan of action for the next day should be in place. Okay, it should be absolutely in place. Some people like to write it down in black and white, some people make notes on their telephones, or some of them have a mental idea. So like what all things you have to do in your profession, in your work, and in your house, okay? That includes learning time with your kids and play time with your kids, everything needs to be mentally planned. Only if you mentally plan will you know which is the most important task that needs to be done the next day. So you can prioritize your tasks and do the task that requires the, you know, the most important task you need to complete when your energy is at its peak. Okay, so we will first talk about the physical energy. Some of us follow very bad diets, okay? Some of us skip breakfast, some of us don't sleep enough. All this will carry through in the way you react to events happening around you the next day. Trust me, I have gone through it. Okay, I was very, very overweight, and there were times when my me to take something from the kitchen, and I couldn't get up because I was so lethargic because of my overweight. Okay, I couldn't. But being a little physically active, okay, I started doing my dance. Not only dance, I started walking every day, every single day, and it brought in a lot of agility to me as an individual, and it also gave me actually the physical energy and the stamina to take care of my kids. And it's a big fact, whether you like it or not, at times what we lack is the physical stamina to go through a day of parenting. So you need to build that stamina. Give yourself half an hour daily to do some form of exercise. Ensure that you're eating well. Ensure that you're sleeping well. So that your energy, your physical energy, if you feel that it is depleted over a period of time, you can maybe go to sleep to recoup. Or else you can walk a few paces. Just walk around your, if you're in the office, you can go down after lunch, walk for 10 minutes, come back. Okay, or if your home, just go down. If you're in an apartment, go down, take a round and just come back. You will feel the change. You will feel in a better position to deal the drama that is going to happen in the house. Okay, so that is the first aspect. And it is also a physiological aspect. All of us have something known as, all of us have this ultradian rhythms. It was mentioned in the paper. The ultradian rhythm is that every 90 to 120 minutes, our body, the high energy state will go into a very, very low trough. So it is very, very important that we recoup it. Okay, so if we try to push ourselves into something beyond that time when our energy is at its low, you wouldn't be able to manage whatever is happening around you emotionally. So that is a connection. Okay, so you need us as parents, we need to be physically active, so that we have the physical stamina to take care of our children and to be there for their needs, because it can be really taxing. So moving ahead, next is the emotional side of it. You know, all of us, I'll tell you something, okay? This is from my observation of my children, from several other children. All our children know our push button, okay? They know exactly where to push, and they will push it, and they'll know that we will react, okay? We will react if... We will react, we'll get angry, or we'll, whatever the reaction is supposed to, they know the reaction, and we'll tell them, okay, now stop it, you do whatever you want. Okay, this happens to every parent, and our children are so intelligent that they've completely realized what our push buttons are, and they know when to push it. Okay, I've always observed when you are on a call or when you can't say no, they come and ask for things. When it's time for their homework or when they have to do something, they will start throwing a tantrum. And most of the times, because you cannot deal with the drama, you will say, okay, fine, let it be. So this is actually a flight or a flee response. You either go to a flight mode where you say, okay, no, I can't take it. A fight or a flee mode, okay? So either you will fight, you will get angry, you will reverse tantrum will be thrown, or else you will be like, okay, do whatever you want. Okay, so that is a natural response, because you are experiencing, you're confronted by relentless demands, and you really don't know. You just wanted them to do a piece of homework, and maybe you must have drawn a line, between the two letters. And my daughter one day said that she started crying because she wanted to draw the line, and I drew the line. And half an hour I took for her to come back into normalcy. You know, she's 5 now. So these things happen to all of us. So emotionally, we have to, this is something that I have done practically, and I have found success in it. Especially, when my son, he knows where to push. So what I do, I used to react. My mode was always fight mode. I would react. I would, by the end of the 15 minutes of convincing the child to do something, it's the parent will get tired. And then we'll be like, you do whatever you want. I think it happens to all of us, isn't it? So what I tried with my children was, I would just sit like this and observe what they're doing. Okay, I'll let the tantrum diffuse, and it will diffuse. You just have to give them 10 minutes. The shouting, the rolling around, the running around, the crying, the howling, everything will stop in 10 minutes if you just give them time to calm themselves. Meanwhile, how will you calm yourself? It is called deliberate breathing. Okay, and this again was mentioned in the paper, and I think it works wonders because I've tried it myself. The moment such a negative stimuli happens in your environment, just inhale and start exhaling for, take very slow, slowly you need to exhale, maybe for 5 or 6 seconds, and it will calm your nerves. Can we all try that now? Can we? Okay, I'm assuming that all of you are saying yes. Okay, so let's all just breathe in and exhale slow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How are you feeling? You know, you feel like something is gone, especially in such scenarios, you know, when you know it will go out of your control. Just do deliberate breathing and let this tantrum diffuse by its own. Because they know that this is the push button. If I say this, my mother will get angry. Okay, correctly they'll come and tell things that they know that you will get angry for. They have clearly understood you as a person. They should be as actually your counselors, because they know all your pitfalls and all your plus points. You know, so this is very, very important, especially for us as parents. We need to have emotional, our emotional energies needs to be managed. We cannot go into a fight mode for everything, nor can we flee, because we are stuck for it, you know, for our lives. So we need to find the middle path where we do manage our energies in a positive manner. Okay. And then there is a mental energy. Mental energy is when, a lot of things that do not require so much of priority comes into the picture. And for example, I saw this with my own eyes, and maybe the character in the story that I'm going to tell you is me myself also. I'm sure this would have happened with some of you at least. One day I was watching my phone. I was seeing something on YouTube. And my child came and asked for something. So I've seen this with many other parents, and I didn't even take my eyes up and look at him or her, or I didn't react. And the child was like, "Hello, I'm asking you for something. Can you please at least respond?" No. Whatever said and done, all of us are addicted to our phone, and it is taking a little bit of too much of space in our heads. Some of us, it could be work related, but how much of a work related it is, you need to give that mental space. You need to free up a little bit of space for your family in your home, in your home time. Home time is a time. So again, I'm going to get to that a little later. And spiritual again is when create an environment where everything is positive, and you try to appreciate people. You try to have that connect with whichever power you believe in as a family. So all this will bring in positive changes in the in parenting. And talking about routines. Routines are very, very important. I need to tell you this, and from my personal experience as a parent, and I've seen a lot of parents trying this, and I got inspired by them, and I started trying myself. There needs to be a time for everything, okay? So their play time or their TV time, now that they can't go out and play, whatever they can play in the house, they can. That is their time. They can do whatever they want during that time, okay? But study time is study time. So what we do here, I'll share that with you. So the kids have long hours of online sessions. They go to the Indian public school. So they have classes from 8:50 to 1:30. My daughter has from 9:30 to 12:30. So we have lunch together. Then 2 to 4 is my time. I might sleep, or I might spend some time watching something or something like that. I don't sleep usually. I try to work from 3 to 4 when my energy is recouped after an hour of rest. Then by 4:30, they have to come and sit across this dining table where we all try and study and do their homework. So if 1 week we fix this time, okay, say 4:30, or if you are a working person, I run a small training firm called Excella Training. So my trainings are usually during the daytime, or else it is like after 7. So I do have my evenings free. Most of my evenings are free. So what I do is 4:30 to say 6, it is our study time. So we do our homeworks, we revise what is taken in the class, and then they have other sessions also, like they say their abacus sessions or their piano sessions, their drawing sessions, everything online. So something extra other than school they learn during this time, and that time is fixed daily. Okay, so apart from the 1 or 2 days on or off there where we might go out during that time, the other days when they are home, they have to follow it. And I need to tell us parents something. If we don't follow it, they won't. So other than telling them to you know, why aren't you doing it on time? You have to show them that to do on time. So every day, because you have to make it your prerogative to come and sit down during that time. Whatever work you have, you can work with them. Okay, they will understand. Our children these days, you know, thankfully they have much, much more intelligence than we had when we were young. So they all understand that they have to work, their parents have to work, the house runs because they work, they go to these schools, they get what they want because our parents are working. They understand. Or else it becomes our responsibility to tell them. If we start talking to them like adults, they will understand. And they will let you work. Okay, they will let you work. 110% they'll let you work. So you need to sit with them, but during that time, your physical presence is required during that time to ensure that they do, you know, that learning happens during that time. Okay. And let me ask you something. Now, all of us, all human beings in this world, we have a tendency to procrastinate. Okay. Procrastinate is putting off something. Now, why do we put things off? We put things off because it is uncomfortable for us. Takes a little bit of work. Yeah, takes a little bit of energy. We know there is some negative consequence attached to things that we procrastinate. Yes or no? As when we were school students, again, we also used to procrastinate learning like our children does, because it takes a little bit more energy than normally, or you know, the state of play and all that to do something. So procrastination is a common phenomenon across adults and young people. We need to find a way to overcome this procrastination. And like I told you, the ultradian rhythm is there for children. For us, if it is 90 to 120 minutes, for the children, it is much, much, much shorter. So you can't expect them to sit for one long hour and finish. So there is a technique, finish their studying. Okay. So there is a technique for young children also. I think I've tried. It works well. I do training for teachers. So I, you know, requested them to try Pomodoro technique. So this was done in early learning to MTech, you know, that level, to PG students, MBA, MTech level, and it was a grand success. It's called the Pomodoro technique, okay? This Pomodoro is a tomato-like clock, okay? So you have to set time on it. There you can find umpteen number of websites having Pomodoro clocks. Usually they say 20 minutes, but for children that is too long. You can say 15 minutes. 15 minutes of focused attention on what they are doing. If they do that, we can give them breaks. First, you can start with another 15 minutes of break. Okay, you can reduce it to 10 minutes and you can reduce it to 5 minutes. So as they go ahead, sometimes they will be able to concentrate for not only 15 minutes, a little bit more, maybe for 20 minutes. Okay, 20 minutes is the maximum in the Pomodoro technique, because they education scientists have said that it is not possible to concentrate focused, you know, beyond that. So our learning, for every human being, it happens in two fashion. The first one is a focused learning, when you're trying to learn something, you know, in that environment, in that time and space where you're trying to learn something. You're concentrating, you're rereading it. Rereading won't help learning anyway. Practice helps in learning. So you're trying to practice it, you're trying to learn, and then you close the book. And then maybe when you're having a shower or when you're walking around, suddenly it'll connect. Okay, your neurons in your head will connect and make the connections and make whatever you have learned very clear to you. That's how all of us make connections. That is how learning happens. So for our kids also, don't expect them to, the moment we teach them in that 15 minutes of focused learning, don't expect them to come back and, you know, tell us whatever we have taught them. Okay. So what, like I said, I give myself half an hour in a day for myself. I walk every half an hour, you know, every day for half an hour. At least that much time I should give myself. I deserve at least so much. Okay. So when I walk, both my children walk with me. They don't walk, they cycle with me. Sometimes it could be outside our house. Sometimes we go down. And that's when we discuss what they learned. Okay. After the homework time, after the study time, then we are casually walking around. I, you know, maybe ask my daughter to say the number names, and she'll go from 0 to 20, the number names, E-L-E, okay, 11. And my son, he's learning about atmosphere now. So we'll discuss about the layers, He'll tell me what he has understood. And so the learning through discussion, through a diffused mode is happening. So like I told you, routine is extremely important. Routine, setting up routine and giving them that focused period of time when they learn, say for 20 minutes you have to do this. And during that time, there should be no other distraction. After that, I'll give you a break. It can be a 10-minute break. Try to make it a physical break. Ask them to just run around the house. It can be a brain break. Okay, brain break is again a break given to the flow of what they were learning, but should need, they have to use their brains for it. For example, it cannot be a mindless activity like watching television. It should be something that they have to use their intelligence to do it. Okay, so one of these things can be done, and then they let them come back, let them finish. Okay, so ask them to focus on the end product. See, you have to finish this. Now that is our task. Let's do this in installments, no problem. So 20 minutes or 15 minutes, go. We are talking about early learners here. Let's give them 10 minutes. 10 minutes till the clock, finish ticking off. You watch the clock or you do your work. And then I'll give you a break. And that rhythm, rhythm in their life and the routine in their life becomes set. So these days, I don't have to tell my children by 4:30 that they have to be ready. They know by 4:30, TV time is over. Now we'll sit and learn, and then we have their other classes, or we go for walk and things like that. So that routine is there. And as parents, it will take every inch of our energy to maintain this routine. But we need to own the fact that we have brought these little ones into this world, and their, they becoming what they become is partially, to a great extent, our responsibility also. So we need to give them that time. Okay, even if it is 20 minutes, even if it is 30 minutes, let that 30 minutes be in a routine fashion. Let it be quality time. Okay, and then I would earnestly request all of you to make them reflect on what they have learned. That is where the learning becomes more cemented. And to ensure cementing of knowledge, I know, especially for preschoolers and early learners, is extremely important. So this reflection can happen just before you go to bed, lying down. You discuss it, in another fashion where they would not recognize that you're asking them the spelling of number 12, but you discuss it through some other fashion. It is imperative that we do it. There are times when, as parents, I have a lot of work. At times, I know that I'm not able to do what I want to do because of my responsibilities as a mother. But we all signed up for it, isn't it? Nobody forced it on us. All of us signed up for it, but we have to find that balance. And the best way to do that is manage your energy as well. So you deal with your children in whatever interaction you have to have with them when your energy is the best. I wouldn't even recommend their energy. Their children, they don't have the cycle only. Okay? But we have the cycle, and it's already set due to years of growing up. So for us, the energy is there. The valleys and the peaks are there. So manage the most difficult part, that is currently teaching your children, ensuring that they do their homework. Then your energy is the best. If you're feeling, they say at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, you're feeling very, very low on energy, then have a cup of coffee, go down, take a stroll, get the fresh air, come back and then sit. And there will be a remarkable difference in your energy level, and you will be able to deal with your children better. I need to also say at this time that your children, our children, need to understand the value of time. Not only their time, they need to understand the value of our time also. So maybe after 8:30 to 9:30, there is no TV. Say, I'll just for an example, I'll tell you a practice. We follow it here. 8:30 to 9:30, there's no TV. Okay, what do they do then? You can do anything under the sun, but no TV. You need to, you can practice your piano, you can draw. So every day I get a card from my daughter because she draws during that time. Or you can pretend play, or you can play Uno cards. Something other than television. Okay, so again, you are forcing them to go into the diffused mode. Okay, so you give them that rest for their brain and they try to make connections through reflections. Practical daily, you know, things that they do, the reflections are try to be, they try and make it. And the insights that they come and tell us, even we get, you know, kind of blown away by the kind of connections they make. So we are a set of parents who would have seen it all. You know, we saw the beginning of computers just coming into the world, and now it's sort of taking it all, you know, on. And then there are two major disruptions that has happened. It is the fourth industrial revolution has happened, and also the pandemic has happened. So we are living in a very, very disruptive kind of a world where technology changes like this. So more than us, our children will be subjected to a lot of volatility. We need to make them strong enough to, you know, withstand all that. So for them, that is why I was trying to tell you that 1 hour at the night when they do, you know, their activity, I've clearly told them that that time is mine. You cannot come to me asking things for me from me because I work during that time. You know, they understand. They off days, they are children after all. You know, when you look it from the reverse lens, no? Always when something happens, it would be really good if you can look that issue from a reverse lens, you know, what are they feeling? Or you can look it from a wide lens, whereas after 6 months, will this fight, will this argument, will anything matter? It won't actually. So I would like to end, I think I've got 10 more minutes, by saying just two more things. Now, after all this, after you have ensured that your child has learned and all this, please ensure that you actually physically show your love and affection to your children. Give them a hug, give them a kiss, because such children, they become more, you know, they do not have trust issues. They feel that they are loved very much, and you know, there is a deep connection that is made there. They are very positive. The outcome is very, very positive because, you know, brain releases a hormone called the oxytocin, and the children become generally happy when they know that they are loved. Even if you reprimand them for something, even if you correct them, at the end of the day, end it with a hug, end it with a kiss, make them feel that they are loved. You know, they're taken care of and their flaws are accepted here. And for them, you are the best. For you, they are the best. And that sort of a physical, showing of affection, especially we are talking about small children here, it requires to be done. All that doesn't take time. So it's not easy to manage time. I completely agree. I somehow, you know, push myself. So many a days I don't watch TV. I cut down on my guilty small pleasures to ensure that I get my work done, at the same time taking care of my children, ensuring that their work is done and they're brought up well. So my husband and me, we believe in something, and I think all parents, all of us believe in just one thing. No matter, we don't care what our children achieve, education wise. I think most parents of today, we are not very bothered. What we want as parents is that they respect elders, you know, they value things and they are courteous to adults, and they share things with their classmates. They just love people, you know, and that is the base. No, I think wherever they go, whatever they do, they'll be successful in it, because the base, the adisthanam nu parayunnathu snehamana, you know. So I think that is the ultimate message that you're trying to tell them. And more than telling them, the best way to make them understand is by showing it to them. And you have to take the extra effort, my dear fellow parents. You try managing your energy and, you know, doing these things when you're on an energy peak. You'll be 100% you'll be able to give time to your children. So before I end, whatever I wanted to say, I will just narrate a small little story that came to my attention and I think is very, very relevant today. So this happened between two neighbors. Okay, so there was this neighbor who was a retired insurance agent, and the other you know, house had an insurance agent who was working currently. He was a very technically pro kind of an insurance agent. So as a part of some colony drive or something like that, both of them got saplings, okay? And both of them planted the saplings, and the younger insurance agent, who was very technologically proficient, he watered it, he ensured that there was a system, a sprinkler system, and there was a sunshade kept for it so that there was ample amount of sunlight that would go in. He tried organic fertilizers, non-organic fertilizers, and he ensured that his plant was growing day by day. His neighbor, he was very casual about it. He did water it. He did the minimum that was required to ensure that the plant would grow. So one day, one night, there was a huge, splash of rain. There was thunder. There was lightning, and it was very windy. And both these insurance agents, they were a little skeptical about whether the plant would withstand. So both of them rushed out in the morning, and when they when the insurance agent, the younger one, when he saw his plant was withered, it had gone, it had died, it could not stand the rain. So naturally, human curiosity, he looked at his fellow neighbor's plant, and a few leaves had gone certainly, but it was still standing there, the plant that the older man had taken care of. So this agent went and asked him, "How come, sir, yours withstood? It was the same seed. In fact, I gave it more care and I nurtured it much, much more than you did. So how come it, yours withstood this and mine didn't?" So this insurance agent, the older one, naturally he had more wisdom. He said in reply, "My dear fellow friend, when you were taking care of it, giving it everything that it required and some more, you didn't let its root to find its own strength. But mine, I had given it only ample amount of water, maybe a little less also. But what it did to the plant was, it went into the soil by its own, its roots tried to find the water by its own, and in that process, it became much, much, much stronger." Now, this is applicable to us parents also. You know, we know that our children are very, very precious to us, but we should realize when to stop nurturing them. We need to let them explore things by themselves so that they know the repercussions, so that the lesson is engraved in them forever, rather than us, you know, saying this over and over again. So I think that's what I wanted to tell all of you. If you these are my inputs. Now, I can be wrong. If I have sounded preachy at any point, please do pardon me. These are a mixture of my experiences as a parent, primarily, and also from a little bit of reading and talking to a lot of fellow parents. And trust me, we are human beings. We will have our days when we just want to be inside a room all alone. You know, I at times, you know, I have both my children have told them, "Edakke nenne amma nu vilikkandirikkyo," because there are days when you can't. But that is natural. All of us are human beings, especially women. We have our times when we cannot deal with all this drama. But after all, I think it's one of the best journeys that any person can subject himself or herself to. It's such a revolutionary journey that you learn so much about yourself in the process of becoming a parent to children. So I really, really hope that your children and you as parents together, you guys should be a team and go for it. Whatever dreams that you have set for yourself and for your child, I sincerely hope that you'll be able to achieve it all.